Welcome, everyone. I want to welcome you to the penultimate episode in the Fundamentals Adventure. It's a little bit like Groundhog Day, only much, much better. It just keeps on coming and giving. So I just want to welcome you because before I hand over to our chair and convener, and also just to give you a little bit of context, we have here tonight spatial practice students from Central St Martins, and I think also maybe some fine arts students. Could we have hands up if we've got any fine arts students? Oh, just one. Mature student. No, I'm sure we've got a few more. And we also have external guests. So for external people who've come, very warm welcome and joining the debate, and we're very happy to have you here. In terms of the format of the night, it's a debate. It's convened and chaired by our guest, Ollie Wainwright, who is the Guardian's architecture critic, and I'm sure you all know who he is. It's a series, this is the fifth in the series, and the process is normally that Ollie will introduce and then we'll have a set of speakers, and then afterwards we have an opportunity for questions and debate to continue into the audience. So the main thing that I wanted to say is it's an opportunity for you to participate, so do keep your questions on hand and be prepared to get engaged afterwards. Also be prepared that we can go for a drink in the bar afterwards as well and continue the debate even longer. And I think that's probably all I need to say, because if I think I've said it so many times, it's boring. So thank you, Ollie. Give him a warm welcome.
Great. Well, thank you, Mel, and thank you all for coming. I know what you mean. It feels like repeating yourself again and again, but I'm going to do it because I know there are a lot of new faces in the audience who aren't quite as loyal to the Fundamental series as some of you. When I was invited to convene a series of talks or debates, I thought actually the most important thing is exposing the kinds of forces and networks that are often invisible and the kinds of things that architects particularly don't always engage with at a very fundamental level. They're the kind of networks that actually end up shaping the city, but that aren't very often interrogated as kind of aggressively as they should be. And I think the art world is particularly kind of lazy in this respect. I mean, there's a huge amount of writing about contemporary art, but very little of it interrogates the kind of networks of collectors, of gallerists, of commissioners, of who's funding what and why it's ending up the way that it is. So that's some of what we're going to talk about tonight, hopefully. I think it's one of the most divisive topics of the six themes that I've chosen. I mean, at its best, public art can kind of startle and delight and make you look at the world afresh and question your city, maybe reveal hidden stories and histories that the city contains. At its worst, it's not only banal, but kind of offensively bad. It clutters our streets and squares with glittering horses' heads and giant helter-skelters. It's the turd on the plaza, to use James Wine's famous phrase, the shiny baubles that developers use to try and distract from the reality of their desolate piazzas. And it's a double crime because it's kind of hated by the public and also despised by the art world, who dismiss it as not real art. So it's a very strange phenomenon. London is the perfect case study, I would say, to look at the current state of public art, because we have some of the kind of worst offending examples. The one closest to where I live is the ArcelorMittal Orbit, which has generated some amazing nicknames, from the tangled roller coaster to the mutant trombone. My favorite is the prolapsed intestine. A £23 million monument to the guy that at the time it was commissioned was the richest man in the UK, the steel magnate Lakshmi Mittal, intended quite cleverly to be a money-making tool for the upkeep of the Olympic Park going in perpetuity. In fact, it's ended up costing the British taxpayer £10,000 a week just to keep it open. And I think in a first for public art, they ended up commissioning another artist to make Anish Kapoor's art better. So Carsten Holler was commissioned to add a slide to this dysfunctional roller coaster, which probably should have had a slide to begin with. At the same time, public art has kind of mutated actually into an incredibly sophisticated industry. Gone are the days when the London County Council would bestow a council estate with a Henry Moore sculpture. Now they commission consultants to come up with 100-page strategies of how to embed art in a development from the very beginning. I guess part of the problem with that is that as public arts budgets have been relentlessly slashed, the onus has fallen to the private sector to deliver these art strategies, usually procured through the Faustian pact of the Section 106 agreement, which, as regular visitors to fundamentals will know, has been a recurring theme. It's the kind of legal mechanism through which a private development gives something back to the community. The problem being that it's a very small pot of money from which all of these different things are usually ladled, from affordable housing to public space to highways improvements. So often a developer can say, well, I'm spending so many million on this sculpture, I can't possibly fulfill the statutory amount of affordable housing. So, interesting situation. At the same time, you know, what is the role of the artist in regeneration and in the kind of development of new bits of London? To my mind, they're the kind of kamikaze pilots of urban renewal. You know, they're the sniffer dogs of the next beast of the city that's going to be cool and developed, but inevitably they'll be moved on because they go somewhere, they go to a cheap area, the rents are raised by the kind of added value that they bring, and they're kicked out. Is that an inevitable sequence of events? Are we naive to think it can be artificially changed and artists can stay in areas? Who knows? That'll be another question for our panel. Before I move on, I should just remind you that there's no phone signal in this building. So if you want to do some tweeting or check your emails, log on to the cloud, use the hashtag fundamentals. So yeah, I've tried to find five experts who know a lot more about this topic than me and actually engaged in the production and commissioning of public art in London. I'm going to introduce them properly before they each speak, but just initially we have sculptor Alex Chinek, then we're going to have Mark Davey, who's the founder of Future City. Following him we'll have Anna Harding, the chief executive of Space Studios, then Hadrian Garrard from Create London, and finally artist Verity Jane Keefe. So to kick us off, Alex Chinek, who is a graduate of Chelsea College of Art. His work unites the disciplines of art, architecture, theatre, and engineering to produce installations that are monumental in ambition and impact, and which amplify and animate the places where they stand. He's made part of Covent Garden Market's Levitate. He's impaled an electricity pylon upside down on the Greenwich Peninsula. And most recently, as a lot of you students will know, he encased a Christmas tree in a block of ice in Granary Square. So without further ado, I'm going to load up Alex's presentation and hand over to him. Thanks.
I'd say thanks, Ollie, but that was terrifying. So. Okay, thanks for having me, though. So my studio create public artworks in the we integrate sculptural ideas and processes into the public realm. So this was a piece that we created in Hackney, where we took a dilapidated factory and we removed one of the smashed pieces of glass from its facade and we scanned it and we reproduced that 312 times. So using 1,248 pieces of glass, we created this enormous architectural illusion. And I'd like to say intentionally, but almost accidentally, they all took a slightly different angle, so it's very beautiful. And this, I kind of stumbled into this. It was a project that we were making in the studio where we were creating a butterfly effect of smashed mirrors. And I started to introduce that idea into windows, and I thought it would be more interesting in an architectural context and returning the material and the narrative back into the realm in which it belongs. And then almost by accident, I'd made a public artwork, and the response was fantastic. It spread all around the world in terms of the internet. And before, at this age, I was just, you know, I was creating artworks, and I was excited if, you know, 100 people saw them. But then suddenly 100,000 people were seeing them, and 100,000 people I like to think were enjoying them. And I stumbled on this idea of conceptual accessibility, which is, I think is a critical ingredient in the public realm. I think in public situations, there's no place for intellectual elitism. And I think this kind of conceptual accessibility is a critical ingredient. And I do that through impact and, I guess, size, but also playful qualities and, you know, simple pleasures like illusion and humor. That brings me on to this. This was a piece that we created in Margate. We removed the front from a dilapidated property, and we created the illusion that the entire front was sliding into the street. And this represented a really exciting collaboration between myself and lots of different industries. And I started to tap into this idea that through collaboration, more exciting obstacles can be overcome. And the impact of this piece was huge. It was very well received. We finished it. And then the next day, the BBC News, ITV News, Sky News, Channel 4 News were there. And I wasn't going into these projects for the publicity or anything to do with a kind of recognition or fame. I guess I was just making work that I wanted to make. But again, I realized the value of creating artworks that could communicate with anyone, irrespective of age, education, previous cultural interest or experience. Following that, we created this. And this was, we were given, again, a dilapidated building. No one trusts me with proper buildings. And it had this vehicular underpass. And we used that, and we created the illusion that there was two buildings and they become completely inverted. An incredibly simple concept, I know, but it was a very complex execution. And I like that balance of a simple idea, but a kind of spectacular outcome. I also like that it was a four-story sculpture, which is very large, but it has the ability to harmonize with the context. So everything we create now is contextually responsive, in that it speaks the visual and material language of the district in which it stands. And I like the idea that it doesn't scream for attention, and people could walk past it. And I tried to get this balance of spectacle and subtlety, and that's something the windows did very well, but this did so also. I'm conscious of the idea, I suppose, that people haven't consciously walked through the gallery doors to see the experience, and so they might not enjoy it or want to see it. This was the piece for Covent Garden. We created the illusion that the entire top half of the market building was hovering. What we did was we scanned a building on the other side of the piazza and created a one-to-one replica. But because Covent Garden is this place of kind of recreation and magic, this kind of illusion felt applicable. It was also about creating something of size that had an incredibly kind of harmonious relationship with the buildings that surrounded it, which A, from a logistical perspective or an administrational one, allowed us to realize something of this size in such a location. But it also elevated the believability of the impact and the illusion at play. And this was a considerable undertaking. I kind of tiptoed into a territory of project management. I suppose there was over 100 people that worked on it. And the hovering structure weighed 5 tons, and we used 15 tons in the market stool on the right-hand side. So this was very much about tuning the work to the contextual situation, but also developing an artwork which had an immediate wow factor and impact, which works in the context of Covent Garden, where people go once a month, once a year, or even once a lifetime. This was on the national news in 35 different countries. This was a piece where we teamed up with a wax manufacturer and we cast 7,500 bricks in paraffin wax. We then melted the house over 30 days. As I say, this was near London Bridge, and we realized this at exactly the same time as the hovering building. But because it was near London Bridge Station, I guess the same commuters would see it every day. And so what we tried to do was create an artwork that would tell a story. So with Covent Garden, it was a one-off impact. But with this, it had a very much a beginning, a middle, and an end. And the same people could see that journey and that process. 7,500 wax bricks, wax windows, wax doors, wax glass. A piece we created on the South Bank, something that we designed. I was so sick of building sites. We designed we could install overnight, a completely freestanding structure. And then now, increasingly, we let the history of the location inform the idea. I take the idea that, I appreciate this is a ridiculous comment with what's behind me, but if it has the feeling that it's always been there, or could have always been there, it stands the best chance of succeeding in that particular location. And for the Greenwich Peninsula, we created this, and the peninsula was the largest oil and gas works in Europe, so it has a history of power generation. A very prominent building, like it or not, on the peninsula is the Millennium Dome, which has a structural language of leaning lattice steel. There's also a beautiful redundant gas tower which has the same sculptural language. So it's about lattice steel and this kind of narrative of power generation. So we created the illusion that an entire electricity pylon was standing on its tip. Again, a simple concept, but a very complex path to reach that visual moment. 25-meter deep foundations, 110 tons of concrete counterweighting the structure, unexploded bomb tests, soil contamination tests. And this is kind of the role of a public artist operating on this level now. You tiptoe into this realm of project management and administration and logistics, and it's great. There we go. Thank you.
You don't literally have to finish when they're gone.
No, but I'm done.
Oh, wow. Perfect timing.
Okay, Mark, sorry.
Yeah, that's all. Okay, wonderful. So let me just load it. So next up, we have Mark Davey of Future City. He founded Future City in 2007 to promote the culturally led development of our urban centres. It's now grown to be one of the country's leading public arts consultancies. Regent's recent projects include Richard Wilson's spiralling slipstream sculpture in Heathrow Airport, the art strategy for the new Crossrail stations, and they're currently working on the Illuminated Rivers project to light up the Thames bridges. So over to Mark.
You know, in 5 minutes, it's really hard to know what to say. I thought what I'd do is talk about structural things. London is a city of ideas. London is selling IP, and we're told repeatedly that we're a world cultural city. And you've even got the World Cultural Cities Network that the GLA and BOP, Burns Owen Partnership, are supporting. So this, I think this idea of a cultural creative place is at the basis of our practice. A couple of days ago, we saw the launch of the this idea of the creative estuary with the mayor's idea for a whole series of creative things happening along the Thames going east from London Bridge. And so it's not surprising if developers want to be part of that process. They're building in these places. If they keep hearing and seeing and reading that we're a creative cultural city, that the finance sector is being overtaken by the creative economy, the knowledge economy, then they all try to do things as part of that. The big issue is really whether we in the arts sector are part of that process, or whether we stand back and just laugh at them as through the picket fence or the chain fence. So, I mean, it's interesting, when we started Future City, we unashamedly wanted to get into places that artists weren't getting into. We wanted to be at the table alongside the architects, the engineers, the landscape architects and the developers. We wanted to create alternatives. And we wanted artists to have a better opportunity to make works rather than relying on a predominantly public sector funding process. And I speak as someone who was a practicing artist and a teacher. So that's been our practice idea. When the Illuminated River project came up as an international competition, it was an architectural competition. We put an artist forward with an architect supporting and a team supporting his vision, Leo Villarreal. And I mean, I say to a surprise, we won. But I think we were the only practice that had an arts-led idea. So this was a big moment for us. It was the first time I think we'd gone for something where we'd gone into territories that artists don't normally go into. We're not big enough, we're not strong enough, we're not visible enough to be in those places. And so again, the argument is, if we want to be there, how do we get into that area? So this is also Greenwich Peninsula. We challenged the idea of the public realm and said, you know, you're dealing with landscape and so on. Why don't we do something different? And we persuaded them to do the P5K, the Peninsula 5K running track, a sculptural running track that will run the entire length and undulate through and up and around the new development, working with artists and engineers. We challenged their energy centre, a cost-strip box with a chimney the size of Knowlton's Column, ugly, simple, even the architects had given up on it. We challenged that and we said, this is the size of Knowlton's Column. It should be reflecting the energy that's going to be putting the energy into the peninsula. We ran an international competition won by Conrad Shawcross, who created the optic cloak solution. The building itself will probably have a visitor center for children to see how energy is made. So challenging what the developer saw possibly as a kind of box covering plant and machinery and doing something much more imaginative with it. So in a lot of our projects, I would say they're funded by appropriating other budgets, by offering alternatives, but often they're excavated. I was saying earlier to someone, I don't think I'd know what to do if someone actually came to me and said, I have £1 million, I'd like to do an art project. Most of ours are discovered. As part of the Greenwich Peninsula, of which there are a whole series of things, we also took the coal jetty and created this as a kind of experimental place where things happen. We started with Shunt, an immersive theatre. Something and Sun are on there at the moment with Farmopolis, but it was the idea that this place became a place of experimentation for what will be a huge community over the next 20 years. So what we've found is actually, unlike this 106 issue, which I see very much as a kind of, it's a retro thing, it's something that did happen. Plop art, the 106 money, never very much actually. On the whole, it's usually under £100,000. not enough to do a major work, not enough to pay the artist properly. It's a tick box planning issue. The artists don't really know why they're doing it. Often the architects get to do it instead. It's not a very effective way. And it kind of gets the developer off the hook. We should be in there, actually at the table, negotiating on real budgets and real ideas, not relying on the normal process of architects at the top of the triangle and the arts and all the rest of us at the bottom waiting for our morsels offered to us by whoever decides art is a good thing. And when Crossroad came up to us and said, we'd like to do a public art strategy, we said, what was the budget? And there wasn't one. So we said, well, don't do it then. Don't have a public art strategy. What we did instead was we developed a strategy which linked us up to galleries, looked at London as a sort of gallery market, ran the idea of a kind of international series of artists from Mikhail Rovner, Richard Wright, Douglas Gordon, Spencer Finch and others, each working on an intervention that used the architectural, engineering and landscape budgets for the stations. As one of the projects, this is Spencer Finch, with his 110 cloud index. These are every cloud in the skies over Britain etched into the glass in the new open court in Paddington, but then funded by Heathrow, who we'd worked with 2 years before on this project. So if I could reel back, when we first came into this, we were saying to Heathrow, you're the gateway to a cultural city. Apart from a beefeater on a vinyl as you come into Terminal 3, how do I know I'm in London? You know, it's grey steel glass, there's planes, so what? This was the new Terminal 4 court, about the same size as the Tate Turbine Hall. And out of that, we challenged the idea that instead of a kind of arguably mundane landscape budget, with a mundane landscape answer, why not ask five artists to come up with ideas for an intervention that took on that space? So Satsuma Majima, Sarah Zay, Kerith Wynne Evans, and others made a series of proposals. Richard won with his slightly crazy idea of a plane tumbling and spinning through the space and soaring out the other side. My God. So I've only got another 37 slides, so do I get one more minute? One more minute. UVA's Alan Turing's monument at Paddington, not a 106, funded by British Land. I think it's a powerful piece of work. And over at St. James Development, the RCA's new experimental space for students. This is not a gallery. It's tough. There is no control by the developer about what goes inside that space. It's completely down to the students. The street furniture is a piece by Peter Newman. Maybe I'll finish with this idea of using the retail space and commercial space differently. In this case, scooped up and given away free and offered to the English National Ballet, who've moved into this site over the road from the Greenwich Peninsula. So what we've effectively done is try to challenge the idea of how things are how we get them. We've tried to provide alternatives. We're a bit of a lone voice out there, but we have produced, I think, and been very fortunate as we've got bigger to get larger and larger projects and to be taken more seriously. And so there is an appetite, we think, for the kind of work we do and for what artists are increasingly doing, which is hybrid, multidisciplinary, more work. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark. For any artists in the audience, Mark is a man to collar in the bar afterwards to win your next commission. Right. Let me just see. This one? Cool. So, next up we have Anna Harding from Space Studios. She's been the chief executive there since 2005. Space is a non-for-profit artist support organization founded in 1968. Now it runs 19 artist studio buildings across 7 London boroughs, providing affordable workspace as well as support programs, including exhibitions, artist residencies, bursaries, and training opportunities. So over to Anna.
Probably noticed from Ollie's introduction that public art is a very, very tiny part of what we do. So I'm going to talk about 4 public art projects that I think are interesting because they give they bring community together and give people space to talk about change in the city. And then I'm going to talk about 2 studio buildings where we've worked with developers, which I think tackle some of the thorny questions of this debate. Okay. So The irony is that we started this public art programme because we couldn't afford our gallery space anymore in gentrified Hackney, so we moved our programme out onto the street. And so in the last 18 months, we've been commissioning four artists or collectives a year to make work which engages in the change in the locale in central Hackney. So this is a really gentrified area, primarily because we're being priced out by the tech sector and the desk space people, who have these kind of like tax breaks to come and invest in spaces that used to be inhabited by artists. And if you cram lots of people into desk space, you can make loads of money. And so they're kind of pricing the artists out. It's a pretty awful situation right now. I'll talk about some commissions. This is from last summer. We commissioned a collective called the Walking Reading Group to make a series of walks in Hackney. And the way they worked is that you were provided with a set of texts in advance, and then as you walk, you discuss the texts and exchange partners, and there's a theme for each walk. So the collection of walks was around the theme of commons, and it was tackled from various angles. And these were fabulous public artworks because they really brought community together in a very deep way, in that you're walking with individuals who you've never met anymore, and you're swapping partners as you go, and finding out in a very deep way about different people's take on the area you're walking through. And each walk was accompanied by an invited guest. And one that I went on was accompanied by Alex Colas, who's a political theorist, who halfway along plonked a blender on the floor and the ingredients to make gazpacho. And at the end of our walk, we went in a cafe, and his kind of gesture was to challenge the cafe to see if they would actually make the gazpacho with his ingredients. So that was an interesting commons experiment. This is a commission by Josh Bilton, which was about Portland stone, and he made an immersive sound work based on the quarry in Portland and the sound of cutting the stone, and then accompanied by a sound walk around Hackney, which was really looking at the built environment through the symbolism of Portland stone. So it was visiting graveyards, Hackney Town Hall, churches, and it was a very, very beautiful detour around the edges of Hackney, not the gentrified bits. This is Yvan Argot, who is a Colombian artist, and he made this big hoarding for the front of our building. And as you can see, it's really commenting on all the kind of hoardings going up around building sites in the area. And what he did was interview Hackney residents to attempt to discover what might be a desirable addition to Hackney. So you see he's come up with this fancy garden and a swimming pool and different pop-up spaces. I could be very critical about these projects as well, and whether they really achieved engagement with a community, how deeply he consulted, all this stuff. But I don't have time in the 5 minutes. I'll just move on. Pointing it the wrong way. Florence Peake, we commissioned this piece of work, which is called The Keeners, and which was taking the Irish Celtic idea of keening, i.e. mourning for losses, and we put out an open call to people to submit something they wanted to be keened over. So people submitted things like the loss of armpit hair, the loss of a certain kind of pickle, the loss of kids playing out in the street. And this is in London Fields. So it was a kind of lament about gentrification in many kind of ways. And then I shall... Okay, so those are some of our public art works. Okay, just one thing I wanted to say, that taking place in public space doesn't mean artwork is immediately publicly accessible. And for instance, going back to the Florence Peak in the park, there's somehow sometimes an assumption that if it's in a park, there'll be a face painting stall and it'll be immediately accessible. I mean, this was a highly conceptual work. You could take it on many levels, but just because it's public doesn't mean that you have to immediately get it and it should be simplistic. So I just wanted to chuck that in. So public art is just a very small part of Spaces activity, our main activity being supporting artists through providing studio space. So I don't think our commissions, our public art commissions, have anything to do with the placemaking industry, which is what this talk was about. But I think sometimes our studio developments are very much about the placemaking industry. And I'm going to just show you a couple of projects which have happened around the Olympic Park, which is one of the biggest kind of regeneration projects in London in the last century, probably. So this is the White Building, which is on your left, and it's a partnership project with the London Legacy Development Corporation, who are a big developer. So the ironies of this is, should we do it or shouldn't we do it? It's a five-year pop-up project. It's making an area full of artists more noticeable, so it might put the price up. We're pragmatists, like, we get this for 5 years. It's a beautiful building. Lots of artists have made a lot out of it, so someone's going to do it. It was sitting empty. Okay, this is my other problematic regen developer project. This is here east on the Olympic Park, which is a data centre primarily, which is being presented as London's new innovation hub. And we're going to have these studios along the gantry, which have been in the planning brochures, are described as a cabinet of curiosity. And so we know we're being used because somehow artists are seen as attracting all these tech industries to the location. But we're part of a 106 agreement. We'll get some affordable space and artists will make good use of it. So we can handle being used because we understand the benefits. So we don't mind being doing those partnerships when you enter them in a knowing way. There you go.
Great, thank you, Anna. This is, I think, one of the most interesting projects for us to talk about later. Okay, so. Next up, we have Hadrian Garrard, who is the director of Create, or Create London, which he founded in 2012. It's an organisation set up to explore the complex and changing relationship between artists and communities in East London. So very timely for tonight's topic. They've commissioned Jeremy Deller to build an inflatable Stonehenge, Marvin Gaye Chetwynd to design children's soft play area in Barking, and they were the first people to commission Assemble for the Folly for a Flyover pop-up community space under an underpass in East London. So over to Hadrian.
Okay, not a mega fan of public art, so just to get that out. So, Assemble were architects slash artists slash clever people. This was a project in Hackney Wick in 2011 that we commissioned, and it was very popular, and lots of people came. It was extended by about 4 months. There it is again. Such a nice looking thing. And it was the first time I think anyone gave any money to Assemble, and it involved lots of volunteers, and it was terrific. And then it was taken down, and at the end of that summer, the underpass kind of returned to its empty state, and we found that quite unsatisfying in some ways. So we've moved as a commissioning and producing organisation to projects that are more permanent in one sense. We like to live with projects for a long time, and that's partly because we think the relationships between communities and artists and people are incredibly complex. And you need to leave room to make mistakes. When we started, we were a kind of government quango working within seven East London boroughs, and we worked in this way, writing policy around what the situation was for culture in East London for a number of years without doing projects. And then we started doing live projects. And one of the things that kind of screams out when you think about East London is it is still Europe's largest cultural quarter, with just about 13,000 artists living and working, just about clinging on. But if you live in East London, you're less likely to walk into an art gallery than if you lived anywhere else in the whole of Britain. So there isn't much of a relationship between the art world and people in East London, different kinds of people. And our projects are kind of looking at different ways to think about the value of artists in cities and think about what things artists can do. And this was a leisure centre. So Barking Council were building this great big shiny leisure centre, and they were about to book the Jolly Jungle to go in as a three-storey thing for kids and parents. I'm a parent, and I'm kind of still in recovery from being dragged to leisure centres across East London. They smell of disinfectant. They're usually purple, yellow, green, orange. They give you a headache. That's a jukebox on the wall, and this is Marvin Gaye Chetwynd, who we work with on this project. It plays really great music. There's a really nice cafe. There's no colour. Although, there's now a Peppa Pig little machine in the corner, and the space is kind of developing over time, and we're quite happy with that. That's here for 10 years at least. People talk about community engagement in quite a lazy, clumsy way, and it's really hard to work with people, and it takes a big commitment, a lot of expertise. This is a mural, and murals, when we commissioned this in, I think, 2013, this is Chad McHale, have a really interesting history in London. The curator that we worked with on this project, Marika Steedman, wrote a book when she was at Whitechapel called Reclaim the Mural, and it was a kind of survey of London murals over the past 30 years. They're very political, very public, at this time, quite unfashionable works. This work is a history of the Becontree housing estate, where Verity is working at the moment, and she's going to talk about that. But it's a really exciting part of London. It was the biggest housing estate in the world when it was built in the 1920s. And this is a mural that was made by Chad, who he worked in that room for 3 months, and he did no research at all. And the history of the estate was done purely through conversations with lots and lots of people over that period of time. And in that mural, there's the Hitler Youth visiting in 1937. There's some quite political stuff. There's the BNP on a campaign, being a man being thrown off a white horse in 2010 when they nearly took over the council. This is in Becontree as well. This isn't public art, but this is a house. And on Becontree, there was a farmhouse that was about 200 years older than all the other houses. We've turned it into a residency for artists to stay, to live, and we're doing a series of residencies. This is Christina Ford on the left. She's a local resident who's an artist and theatre maker. Artists are working in the house for 4 or 5 months at a time, and on projects that range from performances to films, and we're there for 25 years getting to know this area. You don't just make a vibrant city. You can't talk about London being vibrant and exciting just by putting art everywhere. Artists are being priced out of London. There's a real crisis. People can't afford to live in London. Half of the team that work with me can't afford to live in London anymore. This doesn't look like a political work, but this is in Poplar Bath. This is Anthea Hamilton. We worked with Freeze on this project. It was a temporary intervention again, but it reopened Poplar Bath in the context of Lutfi Rahman's mayoral when he was leading Tower Hamlets Council. There's a big campaign to open this Bath as a public space, and this is the first time in 33 years that building was open to the public. And finally, this is another Assemble project. I really like Assemble. This is a kind of interesting one because this was the biggest public art... It's not finished yet. This is the biggest public art project of the Commonwealth Games in Glasgow. And what was really... This was a collaboration between us and Assemble. And what was really kind of brave and exciting about this project is that a big competition went out to say, what's going to be your big piece of public art for the Commonwealth Games? And I sat on a panel with Amica Dahl from Assemble, and she said very bravely, we don't know. We don't know what we're going to do. And the pitch was, we're going to talk to people. We're going to have a conversation with people that live near the velodrome and find out what they want. So this started a long conversation, mainly with kids who had lost five-a-side football pitches, and another sort of look back in a way to the Adventure Playground movement in London, in sort of post-war London, where kids were facilitated to take control of their spaces. And from a commissioner's point of view, I learned an awful lot through this project because I kept asking Assemble, what's it going to look like? And they wouldn't answer me. I said, what are we going to get at the end of this? And this is the thing about public art, is that you have to arrive at some product that you present and everyone has to live with for hundreds of years. So they never answered the question, and they still haven't answered the question, and it's not a piece of design. They were more worried about who was going to run it, what the board was going to be like. So it was social design, and it was really thorough, and I think less objects, more people would be really great to see. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Hadrian. And finally, we have artist Verity Jane Keefe, who is a visual artist working predominantly within the public realm, using moving image, text, and installation-based work to explore the complex relationship between people and place. She has an ongoing and slightly accidental love affair with outer London, in particularly Barking and Dagenham, where she's recently been trundling around the borough's council estates in her mobile museum van, which hopefully she'll tell us some more about. Over to Verity.
Thank you. I have a disclaimer. I don't really like public speaking, so I'm going to read my 5 minutes off paper, probably more like seven. And I thought I'd talk a little bit about what I do. I've gone to the end. That's not a good start. What I do is go to the end of my slideshow. So, yeah, I'm an artist. I'm from a fine art sculpture background, and like Holly said, I work predominantly in the public realm. I definitely wouldn't label my practice as being public art, but it's certainly a practice that's concerned and reliant upon the public, especially in a time when the public sector is in massive decline. So I'm quite interested in what it takes to make work, funding-wise, logistics-wise, those sorts of things. So I'm going to take you on a quick romp through some slides of my work, not too many, and I'll talk about this in the discussion afterwards if anyone has any particular questions, and then get on to some more reflective thoughts on public art with a capital P. So, as Ollie said again, majority of my work looks at outer London. I've become slightly obsessed with Barking and Dagenham in a healthy way, working there on and off for about 12 years now. So I'm committed to long periods of engagement, of close looking and testing before I commit to an outcome. Many of my commissions are self-generated or often delivered with a variety of stakeholders as clients. So one example is Legoland. I was commissioned by the local authority and then had additional funding from the demolition company and the construction company. I quite like that mix. It makes it quite interesting because then you have to think about the role that your work plays across the different tranches of regeneration. So yeah, I say currently really loosely, it seems to have taken over my life for the last 3 years, on the mobile museum. It's an itinerant vehicle, ex-local authority mobile library, which has been converted into a museum. It's been touring 12 housing estates, constructed with love, and is making a new natural history collection as I go around with and for residents, council staff, anybody that comes along to the workshops. So when I originally wrote the application, it was supposed to be a 12-week project. It's now into its third year. But 2017 is definitely a year of the exit strategy. So how can the work, the ethos, exist without the vehicle or without me? Where does the collection go? How can the lending library be a freely accessible resource? How can the baton be handed on? So I'm particularly interested in what the role and potential of the artist within a regeneration context is, could, and should be. I try to interrogate the notion of public in its widest, transient, and potential future versions of itself, mindful that work needs to make sense to not just those privy to the process, but those that experience the stage of it, the outcome, or see the work in a separate context, away from the place that it's actually produced. So through my work, sorry if you've heard me speak before, because I say this pretty much every time, I try to explore what buzzwords and jargon actually means. So I've got a long list which grows all the time. So from the pages of the brief, in practice, and in clients' desires. So regeneration, participation, consultation, collaboration, community, engagement, legacy, resilience, public, and placemaking. As an aside, I have never, as an artist, said when I arrive in a place, ooh, let's make this place. I'm more curious on how it's used. So now I'm going to pop back to the late 1950s and 60s municipal golden era and introduce some favourites, thinking about the politics involved with the production of artwork, how procurement can often dictate, and how advocacy is key. So I'm from a really ordinary, underwhelming place, which might explain why a lot of my work deals with the celebration of the everyday. Driving to school every day to Kidderminster in the 1980s, I'd see this concrete cast on the wall and a bypass, and was completely hypnotised by it, to be honest. It was built by the Department for Highways and the Environment and had a ribbon-cutting ceremony for the road and the wall rather than the actual artwork, which I think is a really good thing. So on the fountains that have since been removed, William Mitchell, the artist, said, "Fountains are always a risk. Nobody wants to maintain them. They fall into disuse and either accountants or property developers erase them." William Mitchell is still working and has had a varied career pioneering large form concrete cast methods. If you don't know his work, look it up, particularly the Dodie and Diana Memorial, which is quite out of character. So he was employed by the LCC for a period in the 1960s. This was an era of civic pride, integrated embedded artwork and ambition, let's say the golden era of public art. So a quote from dear William Mitchell: "Returning from Rome, I replied to an advertisement in one of the daily newspapers for a designer or artist to assist the London County Council Architects Department to design decorative works for the council's housing estates. This is a marvellous experience. I was working with builders, architects and engineers on vast projects and using a wide variety of different materials." Sorry, I've gone one forward. So going back to this procurement maintenance thought, here's a frieze from Bracknell, whose fate is still not quite guaranteed, but these are three articles from the local paper, 2015, 16 and 17, from left to right, which says the fate of this mural, and it's still up in the air. But might now be doomed or saved, whatever your position is, for a roundabout existence. Where else is there for public art these days when the new shopping centre has been deemed not big enough by the developer? Then we'll go to Hatfield, where Barrett's Homes discovered after gaining planning permission for a new development that this monumental listed concrete wall piece, listed, would need to be removed and retained. It now flanks a block of flats within the development. Lucky gits, I think, that live in that block of flats. Not sure they think that themselves. Now to Tower Hamlets in the late 1950s, and to the Guardian article on public art and comments to the comments section. We'd all love a flow, and perhaps you'll get a chance. As an aside, the Mobile Museum was cited as one of these so-called positive projects. How it is not a piece of art or an art project baffles me, because that is the intention and how it's been delivered. I just think it just doesn't look as snazzy or as sexy as Flo reclining here through representation. One more minute. Drape-seated Woman, or Old Flo by Henry Moore, was installed within an estate in Stepney, to be clear. It wasn't commissioned specifically to be there. After an extended holiday in Yorkshire since the late 90s, happy enough, then threatened with being sold by the previous mayor of Tower Hamlets. Thankfully, I got this email bulletin from London Portals, which I sign up to, in the recreational, cultural and sporting services, saying they were looking for a host to take Old Flo, such as her fate. I personally would prefer custodian, but ho-hum. To the 1980s, Paolazzi. We all know about the Tottenham Court Road saga, no need to go into it. Deinstall, reinstall, deinstall elsewhere at much cost. Finally, to Euston, where there is a problem. This piece, Piscator, which, as you can see from this photo I took the other day, feels pretty bloody public to me. People start smoking fags, having a nice time on their phone, really enjoying it. It's facing decay because no one wants to own it. Commissioned by British Rail in 1980, ownership of the work has fallen into a black hole since privatisation. Network Rail and the leaseholder both deny responsibility, with the Paolazzi Foundation itching to take over the maintenance. This seems absurd to me. And then now to 2008, the site of Barking Riverside. So this is a still from a film I made called Rooms with a View, which followed, in part, the rubble of a demolished estate in Barking to this site, where it was laid as hardcore. The site is destined to be home for at least 27 trillion new homes, the largest undeveloped stretch of the River Thames, the Barking Smile. My questions are these. How can cultural strategy predict what this will, can, and should become? How do we learn from the past so we don't end up with a flow on holiday in Yorkshire, a broken fountain in Kidderminster, and mosaics repatriated across the country? And then how do we make meaningful connections between this place, unbuilt yet planned, with everything else that surrounds it and has come before and will come in the future? Art practice is part of it, art is a part of it, but only if delivered as a meaningful public part of the process. That's it.
Brilliant. Well, can I invite the panel to join me on our lovely sofas? And I think that's a perfect backdrop to leave for the discussion, so we'll keep that.
Here we go.
So I'm sure the audience has a million burning questions. I'm just going to kick off with one or two, but do be thinking what you want to interrogate our panel on. So you guys all have water. So maybe I can start just by picking up on one of Verity's last points, kind of harking back to the golden era when London County Council had its own kind of department for funding and commissioning public art to adorn the new kind of brave new world of post-war council estates. Given that that kind of funding is no longer available and we're all having to rely on kind of piecing little pots of money together, whether they're from developers or, you know, the small amounts of money that are available, How does who's paying for the project influence the work, and how can you remain kind of independent as an artist when there is a developer ultimately behind the project? Who wants to go first?
I think for me it's been a question of writing my own brief and trying not to just have one client, because I think that's... if you're just... I'm doing a commission at the moment in Wiltshire where the developer, the funder of development, clearly doesn't care about the work. I could have made a never-ending cocktail supply with the funding and they would be none the wiser. So I think it's down to your own position within it, but also positioning other stakeholders around you, which makes it much richer and seems much more valuable.
Alex, when you're doing work for Night Dragon, for example, on the Greenwich Peninsula, do they give you free rein or... are there quite strict limits within what you're allowed to propose?
Night Dragon specifically do, yeah. But unquestionably, commissioners come, you know, with the invitation with an objective. And I suppose, as just being a decent person, you have to ask what that is. And then I think it's about understanding whether that relationship is a healthy one. With those objectives in mind. And it is, I'm constantly faced with that question. I mean, I think given the nature of our work, we have maybe 5 phone calls a week from companies, marketing agencies, saying, can you do this with this brand? Can you do this with this product? But typically they try to shoehorn too much of that objective into the outcome. And whereas I quite enjoy the objective that commissioners typically bring, which is footfall and awareness. And it just so happens that those align with my personal objectives. I mean, as an artist, I create work to be seen and hopefully enjoyed. And that's largely aligned with their strategy also. So that relationship works. I mean, I think it becomes difficult when the objective is an overly commercial one, because there's such a fine line between a sculpture and a stunt. And I'll be the first to say that my work treads that tightrope knowingly, sometimes well, sometimes clumsily. And typically, I think, with commercial objectives in mind, they edge you towards the stunt territory. And I must stay away from that, so, yeah.
Mark, how do you find it when you're working with commercially driven companies who want some art?
To answer your question from a slightly roundabout way, I think we're at the end of something. This whole public art debate feels to me very old school, really. It's the idea of an object that was funded separately, that's placed in somewhere in the public realm that we stare at and venerate and so on. Just seems at odds with where we are. Like it or not, the public sector is diminishing, Arts Council funding is diminishing, arts offices in the local authorities are being made redundant, and there are developers. So, you know, we either if we're going to get involved or deal with those people, we've got to try to find some form of rapprochement or communication that allows us to be part of it. So I think with a lot of our work, they're not actually, we've never really been commissioned to do a piece of art. What we tend to do is go in very early on, and the earlier the better, sometimes at least at the master plan stage, or sometimes even earlier than that, and say, why is that landscape going to be like that? Why are you planting those trees? Why? You know, you're just asking why. And often, when you push, you're expecting for someone to push back, and they don't. And you realise that there is almost no narrative. We've got ourselves in such a state now where the master planning process, the machine that generates the developments, is so big and powerful that it just keeps churning this stuff out. So there is actually an appetite for challenge. And so, you know, whether I didn't show later on the slides was a fantastic project we're doing at Great Night in Cambridge, where there are six artists that are working on landscape, play. There's Jan van Heedswijk living in a marketing suite and running a kind of habit. If you look at habitorials.org.co.uk, this brilliant, they've appropriated the language of the developer, living inside their marketing suite, working with the community to build creche, cafe, and so on. So I think this idea of the artist being part of something bigger, then there tends to be ownership by the developer and by their team. The architects and others, once they're part of this process, want to be involved. When it becomes in, like you say, the Mittel Tower, orbital, you know, this idea of this thing lands and then later on something shoehorned down the centre of it, you just get what you pay for, don't you, really?
Hadrian, what are the main funding sources of Create, and do you ever feel compromised by your backers?
Always, yeah. Being compromised by who's giving you money is kind of part of being a commission, I suppose. I think it's really easy to make work that is undermined by the nature of where the money's coming from, or what the building is, and who's living in the flats, and all those kinds of things. I think it's really difficult to make interesting work when there's forces, such big forces, working against you as a commissioner. I mean, I'm interested in work that's concerned with issues of ethics, of politics, that's asking questions, that isn't fixed. So I'm kind of averse to any kind of fixed public art by nature, because I think it's difficult to make work that does those things in a permanent way. We've kind of sailed quite close to the wind in some of our projects. At the time of Occupy, we did a project that was essentially an anti-capitalist project funded by a brilliant funder, and it was difficult. We worked with that. But actually, developing a relationship with I think long relationships with funders are good too, because I think you can earn trust and you can ask questions, you can push funders, and you can put so this kind of in and out with developers stuff. I think is very difficult to make interesting work.
Anna, I mean, does space work with these kinds of organisations, or do you see yourself more set up in almost an opposition against some of those commercial forces?
We work in a lot of different ways. So our commissions are primarily funded by the Arts Council. And so our drivers there are really to enable the artists to be as ambitious as possible with their work and to really help them develop their practice. And we're also really interested in depth of engagement. So we do a lot of things to support commissions, like we produce a video about the work and the making of the work, which is online, and we commission a text that's online. So there's a lot of different ways that you can engage with the project. So if that's funder-driven, I'm not kind of conscious of it being funder-driven. We just think it's good to explore the project in its full. In terms of studios and who funds, we do lots of partnerships to make new studio developments happen because we couldn't afford to do it otherwise.
Can you talk a bit specifically about the Here East
project?
Because I've heard
studios,
that described as a data centre wrapped with a skin of artists, as a way of kind of making it slightly more palatable to the community.
It's a funny one because we've been in this debate since 2006 where we ran a series of events called Legacy Now, and we did one called Visioning the Future of the Broadcast Media Centre, because our aim was to get the policymakers and the artists and the planners all together and to dream up the future. And so we came up with the idea that it could be this kind of innovation creative hub. And it still says that that's what it's going to be. It hasn't, it's getting there. It's got Loughborough, UCL, some techie people moving in, BT Sport.
Wayne McGregor's dance studio.
Wayne McGregor. We haven't got the studios yet, but it's written in their 106 agreement.
And you don't mind being on a kind of shelf, you know, bolted onto
the
outside of the
building?
Well, the
problem with that is it's a very loosely worded 106, which we had nothing to do with, which means that we just have to be grateful for what we end up with. Sorry.
Just leading on from that idea of how a kind of temporary idea can seed something that might become permanent, I was interested that came up in a lot of your presentations, I suppose particularly with the work of Create, how you started out doing temporary things and then realised, actually, hold on a minute, this could inform what comes next. Do you think ultimately the role of a kind of artistic intervention should be or could be to have that longer-term legacy rather than just being a kind of one-off fun wow factor thing? Should it somehow inform how an area develops? And if so, how do you do that?
I mean, it's interesting that a lot of the projects we're involved in are kind of on the industrial sites. You know, the brand, what they call brownfield. So, in a sense, you're often starting from nothing, or rather you're trying to excavate ideas out of history and heritage, the geography of the site, what's on the periphery of the site. And you know, this, we were talking about this earlier and saying that at the moment, the development system is like a pyramid. At the top, you have the developer and then the master planner, and then you have that team. And I remember when I first started doing this about 10 years ago, the people around the table are pretty much the same set of people that are around there now. The world has changed, and language has changed, but the deliverers haven't. And I absolutely believe it's the wrong way around. It should be the other way up. It should be this sort of creative narrative at the top of it, filtering down through until it reaches the bottom, at which the practitioners start to get involved in doing things. And that I think is the problem.
How can we do that? How can we flip it on its head?
The position I'm in at the moment, last year I was really keen to take all of the stuff I've learnt from the process of the Mobile Museum, and also the value of staying working in a particular part of London so long term. Like, how can you apply what you've learnt, which is quite often the stuff that local authorities, developers are crying out to know, the sort of gritty, you know, how people live, like what, you know, the on the street type stuff. So last year I've began tentatively to do work within policy, planning policy, as part of wider strategic documents actually on the team, which has been really challenging, but I think quite valuable, because then you can kind of empty your brain and your knowledge into this document that will last longer than I will last. And then also, one of my main objectives for that is how you make the nature of these policy documents, these strategies, who are they for? Who's the audience? Who's the stakeholder team? If you're producing 400-500 page documents that are impenetrable and you need a degree in planning policy to read them, the value for me is then making that lighter and being quite ambitious about who the potential audience of that is. Like, residents should be able to read it, business owners should be able to access it. So that's the position I'm at with that work at the moment.
In fact, on the Great Knighton scheme that we were working on, the whole project started with a Project Bible, which was working with Trumpington and the local community. And from that was a series of anecdotes and ideas and observations, which were kind of quite loosely collected. It was almost like a kind of visual book. Mm-hmm. And that book was then issued out to the development partners for this huge 500-hectare scheme. And out of that came the idea of artists working within the design teams. So it wasn't plop art, as it were, but it was artists working on, Bloor Brothers, for instance, working on an amazing play area, and London Fieldworks working on an ecology project and others. So that's where I would prefer to be, where there is a sort of, your point, Rhea, but a kind of different kind of language, a different narrative that's actually aimed at trying to hit different targets from the planning professionals, the architect, and so on.
Hadrian, how do you ensure that the temporary things that you seed, you know, do have that momentum and that level of buy-in to actually carry on, you know, after Create has left or after your initial funding has dried up?
We don't always, and sometimes it's quite difficult to do that. It's not profitable. So we've kind of moved from... We're concerned with issues of infrastructure in a similar way to Anna is, I think, in some ways. Artists are losing space, struggling to find places to work,
communities are losing community centres. And so one of the things we're kind of starting to make a bigger commitment to is to when we do a project, whether that's a space where artists are working or the house I talked about, is that we are there for a decade and a bit. And we're finding out that in fact what we're creating a lot of the time is financial liabilities that we have to keep supporting and find models to work with. And that's really difficult and it doesn't really make business sense. But we're running
is it
a charity,
you off
not a business.
At all? I mean, given that these projects do become so unwieldy and you have all that extra level of risk compared to doing a normal, straightforward commissioning project.
I think it's much more easy to do a project where you go in and you take photographs of people and you get some quotes from people and you stick it on your website and then off you go, we're off. And I think it's a very brave thing to do to make an object that's going to stay there for 50 years as well. And I've never really done that before. But it's certainly very difficult to make a big commitment to a place and to stay there for a long time. But I think that's where, for me, that's where the value of our kind of practice is as an organisation.
Alex, do you see your work in having that kind of longer-term impact, or is it more about the kind of magic of a fleeting event? You know, if you don't see it in those 2 weeks, then tough luck.
I guess it depends on the work. I mean, a lot of the work that we've created to date have been temporary. And in many ways, a temporary artwork has a much greater room for ambition. Permanence introduces concerns over durability. Firstly, material durability, and of course, secondly, conceptual durability, and a kind of irrelevance. But I think one thing I like to think is that, and I think that must be championed, is that unquestionably the introduction of culture into an area can have a really positive impact. And it's a difficult one. I mean, I think whether you initiate a cultural momentum or you contribute to one, I think it can be incredibly valuable. I mean, the sliding house that we did in Margate as a case study, we didn't initiate the cultural momentum. Arguably, the arrival of an institution like Turner Contemporary initiated that. But I like to think we contributed to it. And the arrival of art can have an incredibly positive impact to the residents who live there and the people that operate there. I mean, Margate, again, sticking with that, in the recession, it was the hardest hit high street in the UK. I mean, I think over 50% of the shops on the high street shut down. And its regeneration is culturally led, and I like to think that we contributed to that. And in that respect, it's not so much about legacy, but I think we made a contribution to this kind of extended sense of permanence. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, we're working on three large projects, and they're all permanent. And we're approaching them with a different philosophy to a temporary one. Of course, in terms of design, that's a given. But I think coming back to this idea of allowing the history or the story of the location to inform the creative direction is a good place to start. And it's about trying to create something that feels like it's always been there, mm-hmm. as I said. And that's how I try to take on this idea of legacy. Good design and, I suppose, toning down the humour and kind of increasing this idea of historical and contextual relationship with the setting.
I have an issue with this idea of introducing culture, though, because for me, like, places, you'd be hard to find a place that's completely devoid of culture. And I think if you scratch the surface, you can find all different levels of culture that are already there. And I think culture-led regeneration, all that does is bring that bang to the forefront as a imported device, which I work within as well, but I think to say that areas are without culture is,
or to say they get better because culture's there. Because don't forget that UKIP took over the council in Margate five years after the Turner Contemporary. So if you're talking about culture enlightenment of some kind, it's certainly not not working in Margate.
And also, like barking in Dagenham, where we are both committed to working, had 68%. Brexit to leave vote, so I don't think that the two go hand in hand. I think it's much more complicated than that, and that kind of grittiness and interrogation to not make assumptions on what
but
culture
that,
is there.
That idea of culture-led regeneration has been public sector I mean, that was the old RDAs, dropping cultural organisations all over the country, First Sites and Turner Contemporary and others, dropping them into the middle of communities, and often with no connection to the world around them. It was a bit like it landed like a spaceship. So it's, you know, again, this is not necessarily a developer thing. This is something that this country's used as a kind of a toolkit for trying to make change.
Well, the White Building is an example of culture-led regeneration. It's in an area that had studio buildings for years, but they were always invisible. And the LLDC wanted to have something as a kind of beacon for the creative community to attract more footfall to the area and therefore make it more regeneration friendly.
But again, the funding was only for a limited period for the White Building. Yeah. So what happens when that runs out? Has it run out?
Like right now.
So what do you do? Will you be evicted and move on? Is it the inevitable cycle of artists? You know,
we're waiting on a planning application, which keeps getting delayed. So yes, it's a tricky situation.
But is there a danger in those cases when a publicly owned authority intervenes, you know, to seed a project which is inevitably going to be destroyed within the next 3 years?
To be honest, I mean, it's not a good use of taxpayers' money to pay for a 5-year project. Well, I mean, we'd never do something like that. But if somebody's paying for it, and it was Boris's kind of conceit, if someone decides to pay for it, then, well, you gratefully accept. And,
can you not
convince make the most of it for 5 years?
You know, surely it can also be in the private sector's interest to retain artists and galleries on a site because it raises the value, the kind of cultural cachet of the area. Is that a strategy that any of you have
used? It wasn't designed as an economically viable model, and therefore we would have never touched it if it wasn't a funded project.
And I think in the White Building's case, you could argue that it's already done its job. It's raised
it's
the value
done its job. The
massively.
Have gone up.
It's like a festival there.
Is that the right kind of job that we want it to be doing? Raising surrounding land values and then therefore signing its own death warrant?
That was going to happen anyway. That was the LLDC's remit. If we didn't take it on, somebody else would have done the same thing. So what do you do in that situation?
Hadrian, what do you do? You know, given that actually a lot of what CREATE does, you know, you could argue that it's only catalysing this kind of unstoppable gentrification and speeding up the displacement.
I think that's
people.
Quite often a unintended result of things sometimes. I think looking to the future and thinking positively, I think London has to learn its lessons. There is an argument that artist displacement through the city is a fact, and it's like saying Chelsea once was a kind of bohemian hotbed in the sort of 19th century, and it's just sort of moved eastwards and out it goes. You could accept that that's a kind of evolutionary fact. I like to think that London as a productive, interesting place really benefits from artists, and if we carry on this trajectory, we will end up in 15 years or less where arts graduates immediately leave the city because it's impossible to be here, and there may be lots of public art everywhere, but there won't really be any artists, and therefore it becomes a much less productive place. So I think if we're looking at lessons, we need to think about longevity. Artists, I think, need to work a little bit harder to be irreplaceable in communities, let's say. So I'm really interested in models where, particularly in outer London, in places where there's an appetite for inviting or welcoming artists mm-hmm. into communities, but I'd like to look at 50-year trajectories, much longer trajectories, and ways in which artists are encouraged or even in a sort of transactional basis invited to be part of communities in potentially quite instructive ways. But I think I think we need to look at new models, and I think that's where we're heading. We're really interested in that.
Can I just add that the White Building wasn't a space strategy? Mm. In the meantime, we've bought 3 freeholds with 250 tenants with permanent studios. It's just that an opportunity like that pops up on your doorstep. We made a great centre for art and technology with loads of residencies, workshops. It's fulfilled its purpose, but it's not our strategy.
Mm. Mark?
Yeah, the thing that concerns me is I think we could come here in 5 years' time, we could sit here and have the same conversation and nothing will change. If it's not enough to just be moaning from the outside, we've got to try and get inside. We've got to create new models, as you were saying. We've got to create new models that deal with the realities. I mean, we have one project where we convinced the developer to give up the space for 78 studios. Bow Arts Trust are running. They were happy to do it. The other project I mentioned, they gave up all their commercial space because we convinced them that actually, unlike their spreadsheets, that the commercial space had no real value. The value was possibly in some of the development. And so, you know, there are conversations to be had. What they're looking for, I think, is someone to talk to. And if they're only talking to the local authority, if they're only talking to individuals, where are you going to get in to meet these people? How do you get in there to have these conversations? So it's very much up to us to create new structures and mobilise and to group up a bit in order to give them being, I guess, the developer, something to look at and something to talk to. And their agents, who are mostly architects, you know, I mean, we beat ourselves up about, you know, the arts community beats ourselves up, the front line against all this. But you'd argue that architecture is a lot more to, you know, to do, we have a lot more to do with architecture than public art, I think.
Let's see what the architects have to say about that.
Yeah, come on.
I think it's time to open it up to questions and provocations and heckles.
What, done now, haven't
they? Or not. I've got, okay, first one on the front row.
Yeah,
and then one back there.
Hello, is it on? Yeah. When you get into the realm of like making parks and doing policy and stuff, what's the value of the word art and artist?
Value of the word art.
I don't think I understand.
Why do you call that art? And why do you call yourself an artist if you do that?
In the policy world, you mean?
When you start doing things like...
In the world, generally.
For me personally, because that's what I am and that's what I do. And I'm not explicitly 100% working in policy. I don't wake up and be like, oh, I'm going to do policy today. I wake up and I'm an artist. I make things. I want to contribute to the world. I'm scared about the state of the world, the same as everybody else. But inherently, I'm an artist. And the policy thing is a desire for me to interrogate this legacy issue that I struggle with. When you're working in a temporary mode, how can you leave something behind that's more permanent? It's out of my comfort zone to work within a policy environment, for sure, but I'm doing it because I can see there's value. And with regards to the architecture, my entry into this world was via architecture practice. I was an artist at Muff for 5 years, which is where I cut my teeth. So I worked within an integrated team as an artist, very much as part of wider projects, where you could see your work getting taken and shaped as part of bigger schemes. So I think the value is immeasurable.
Yeah, Mark, how do you justify value?
I'll give you an example, actually, of a park. So in Cambridge, the Cambridge Biomedical Campus is one of the biggest Europe's biggest research centres for medicine. And Wellcome Trust are there, and Papworth and so on. And the original landscape scheme for that was a rectilinear, what I would call cut-and-paste, rectilinear, problem-solving piece of design. And we challenged it, and we just said, what is this about? What's the narrative of this space? What is it meant to be doing? And we managed to persuade them to instead give up the budgets for the landscape and to put it out as an artist competition, won by Ryan Gander. And Ryan Gander had this great moment where he came in, there was a whole room, 30 people, clinicians and others, sitting in the room, and he came with one piece of paper, as I recall, and then said he wouldn't show it to them because he felt that perhaps they wouldn't really want to do what he was showing them. And, of course, that was great reverse psychology because they then wanted to know what was on the piece of paper. And it was a picture of Glastonbury after everyone's left, you know, that chaos of debris and tents. He said, that's what I want to do. And I remember just staring at the table, well, that's not going to happen. And he won. And that's what he's doing. It's a kind of chaotic landscape of fiberglass tents and turnstiles and pub signs. And I think that's what artists do really well, is they challenge and they provoke and they break the rules and they think laterally and they talk to people who others... I'm not saying that landscape is not a good thing. It is in the right place, and often with artists, it's a very exciting thing. But artists are provocateurs. That's what they should be used for.
Anna, when we're talking about value, you know, given that land or a building for housing is so much more valuable than if the building is used for studios, how do you justify kind of your value and the value that space brings to an area or a regeneration project?
To whom? When? I mean, to a developer?
To the forces that are pushing you out.
Well, they're market forces.
So how can you convince the market that you're worthwhile?
It's very difficult. We have a few enlightened landlords who are a bit more sympathetic. We have many who are just, it's just about profit and bottom line, and you're stuck with that. I mean, I work for a charity that has a remit of supporting artists, so that's what I do. But I think in what you were saying, public art, parks, there's loads of other creative solutions that are appropriate, not necessarily art. I sometimes run up with local authorities who've decided that artist studios are the answer for every redevelopment context. And I have a real problem with that because, of course, that's my job to promote that agenda, but there's loads of other industries that also need space. And I find it like, you know, when you see like car spray shops and fabricators being moved on to make way for artist studios, it kind of sucks. Because we're the kind of like friendly face of regeneration, because somehow it's nice to have artists around and they don't make like lots of noise. And so it's a bit of a weird situation to be in.
Should we take the next question? There was one back there, yeah, stripy top, and then one at the front here.
I think we've rightly said, well, some of you rightly pointed out, but not explicitly said, that artists are perhaps part of this problem and arts organisations are part of this problem. Is there a way that artists could be kind of put on the spot a little bit more and pushed to come up with some solutions to the problem of regeneration, the problem of the housing crisis that has kind of come up throughout this, and rightly so? Are there projects that are doing this? Verity, you talked about influencing policy. And Hadrian, a little bit more about long-term, working long-term with communities. But are there artists that are doing this, or could artists actually more actively step up and really just get involved with policy and start, you know, offering some solutions?
I mean, but I suppose why is it just our job? I think there's so many people that need to step up.
It's not your job, but as an artist, artists have got responsibility for doing that.
No, like, I think we've artists all got responsibility. Working, local authorities have responsibility, developers have responsibility, commissioners have responsibility, residents have responsibility. It's everybody's job, and I feel like everybody collectively should step up. Because artists aren't going to save the world.
I think you're stepping up, so it wasn't having a go at you.
I know you're not, but yeah. I think that so quite often a lot of pressure is put on artists. We're wheeled in, not me, the royal we, are wheeled in to save things and make places better. And I think not every artist is up for it. Not every artist wants to do it. They want to sit in their studio and just make work and have a nice time.
But at the same time, artists have always been opportunistic, particularly when it comes to space. And it's like, you know, you look at Hackney, the reason Hackney is such a creative hotspot is because it was total chaos in the 80s. Yeah. And artists took advantage of that in a perfectly practical way. But when you move into arguing for public subsidy, like, oh, we want, then there is an implication of public service in that sense. And I think it does get quite complicated. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something worth looking at. I don't think artists should necessarily say we deserve to be able to stay in this building because we are artists. I think it's a much more complex issue.
In the Hackney context, regeneration is very much the fault of a local authority rather than the artists. Artists have been there for decades and there wasn't any regeneration going on, but it was actually the council that decided to start Broadway Market and all these coffee shops and bars coming along.
I mean, please. Everybody here is the bloody coffee shop. We are the coffee shop.
No, no, no.
This is it. We are it.
I'm glad you can afford the coffee, because I know plenty of people who can't.
But anyway, the trap that we've got ourselves into, or that we've found ourselves into, is the arts have been predominantly public sector funded for a long time, and we're finding ourselves moving out of that period, and we're slightly at sea. And so, you know, there are solutions, but they're not the solutions that exist at the moment. There was someone who used the expression I read recently, the V of history, you know, the end of a period and the beginning of something else. And I kind of feel in the arts that's where we are. So, you know, I can't give you an answer, but I do feel that the arts can be more influential and be part of the process. But not if we're, on the one hand, we're inside being funded through various public sector kind of organisations and made as a special case by the deputy mayor, as, you know, all developers should give studios to artists. God knows what that means. You know, what, 6, 3, 120? And what do you do with these studios? And how are they run? Mm. You know, it's just an easy...
Alex, as an artist, do you feel pressure on your work to have that kind of wider impact, as the questioner was asking? Do you have a kind of moral duty?
Well, I mean, with the work itself, I suppose I think it has an accessibility that works. But I mean, we make best efforts to engage beyond just on the work itself. I mean, somebody who works with me, I suppose for me, I mean, she works 3 days a week, and all she does is that strategy at present. She's been doing it for about a year. I mean, what a lovely day with the siding house on Margate was. We closed the road. We did these hand-drawn invitations, and we dropped them to all the surrounding streets, and we closed the road. And there was a huge street party, and we hired 2 cherry pickers, and all the kids queued up, and they went up, and they were looking at their roads, and they could see the artwork from a different angle. And then, that was a nice day. But a project that we're working on currently in Sheffield, we're putting so much time into this kind of strategy. I mean, for example, I can only do what I think I'm good at, you know, and that's my means of, I suppose, doing my best in that respect. So we've spent a lot of time at the local school, and it was interesting. I mean, we went there. It's a 90% Muslim community. Quite a few that the children in the school don't speak English. And we went there, and I think maybe 8 out of the 10 classes, no one in that class knew what a public art was, public artwork or sculpture was. And we showed them my work, and their favorite piece across the board was the Peeling Road. So in early April, we're going to, outside the school, install the Peeling Road. And I mean, what can I do? I'm just trying to excite and hopefully inspire. Mm-hmm. And that's the way we do it. I mean, from a creative perspective, the budget's growing, and we're dedicating a large amount of it to ancillary commissions. I mean, we're championing this idea, which is a cliched one, but it's a lovely one, made in Sheffield. And that refers to the manufacturing of the artwork itself. But there's so much activity that happens around the works, like signage, branding, photography, documentation, filmmaking. And all of that, we're commissioning Sheffield practitioners. So my whole team that I typically collaborate with, we're not working with any of them.
It's interesting that artists now feel this pressure. You know, when Henry Moore made Old Flow, he didn't care about the council estate that it was going in, didn't do any community engagement. He just wanted to make a nice sculpture. What's wrong with artists just doing that?
Well, that's a really good point, actually.
Well, you need 7 of them as well.
It was
like...
Yeah.
Yeah. Even more lazy.
I think that's a good point, actually. Oh, sorry, Richard. There is a point about, which, you know, as you mentioned, joy and magic and kind of beauty that we've poor old artists now with the provocateur and the proletariat rising against the developers, you know, but they're also making really beautiful things and want to. So we've got to be careful here that we don't see art sort of pushed into some, you know, particular little kind of corralled into an area. It's also just great sometimes to work with artists who want to make extraordinary things. I think the Illuminated River project, from one who's working with Leo Villarreal, it's a very beautiful, ambient, light-based work. You know, and so there is room, I think, in the city for beauty and magic.
Okay, next question from Richard. Richard, and then the one right at the back.
You might have already sort of answered this, but if we lock the door now, and we don't let anyone go home, and no one's allowed to go home until they've told us how many languages they speak, what cultures they come from, what they grew up with, what they've heard their parents say, what they've heard their grandparents say. And, you know, half the audience here, no idea where barking is. I've got no idea where barking is. That's a joke. Sorry, I don't know where barking is. You know, this is an extremely... You know, London is 25 million people. It's Bristol, Birmingham, across to Norfolk. You know, it's a lot of people. But in world terms, it's not very much. So this, we are actually talking, this is a village meeting. You know, this is a parish council discussion about culture. And my question really is that if this is a seat of learning and it's full of biologically young, energetic, thoughtful, imaginative people, that's what happens between 15 and 30. It's given to you. It doesn't last, but you get it then. What in the hell has happened to chimneys that they have to have jackets put on them? When Alec's speaking, you can hear, you know, in fact, really, a lot of you, you speak, I can hear how much you care about what you do. I don't, frankly, mind much about what you do. It's that you care about it. What's Mr. or Mrs. Chimney doing? Do you understand what I'm asking?
No.
No. It took quite a long time.
I thought you didn't.
No.
I mean, why are chimneys? Why are chimneys so terrible that they have to be...
Are you referring to the vents on the Granite Peninsula?
Yeah, why...
Oh, okay. It's a vent, I'm sorry.
Well, it doesn't matter. It's a chimney, it's a vent. Yeah. But I suppose the answer is, why not?
In a way, why is the... It's let's call it the ground plane of our culture, the way, you know, our housing, our the furniture we're sitting on here, the lighting in this place. Mm. Why is it so? Where is this care? Where is this death?
You're thinking of kind of nihilistic.
It's a rhetorical question, but I think it needs, in a seat of learning, it should be asked.
Yeah, I think just leave it as it is.
So why the need to dress up everyday things?
Or dress it up. Yeah, I mean, Conrad might take exception to dressing it up, but, you know, if you know, maybe he would see that he had an alternative to create something instead of. It doesn't matter if it's functional. It's a functional. It still does what it was meant to do. But he's taken it and done different things with it. It's one of the things I think is very beautiful about that object is that he's made it lighter, more efficient. It's a more elegant structure than it was before. It was an ugly, badly designed object.
But why was it badly designed in the first
Well, because the reason for doing it was that at the beginning was they wanted to cost-strip efficient but not particularly attractive object to do a job. So you have to make a judgment, is, well, leave it as it is, or maybe there's an alternative and do something with it. I think we took that judgment. Yeah.
Obviously, my point was political.
Yeah, sure.
Mr. or Mrs. Chimney needs a fucking good talking to in the first place.
Why?
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 Because there was a period, dare I say it, somewhere around the Industrial Revolution, where all of us would be working in the Industrial Revolution. We would be fussing about nuts and bolts and thicknesses of plates, and that's why people talk about Brunel. I don't believe he went to art school. So there used to be lots and lots and lots of things of astonishing quality, which we didn't bother to call them art. They were just in the culture. And I would like to live in that culture. But not 200 years ago.
I would too.
I think it's about how it comes down to contracts, really, and how contracts are now disaggregated.
It's kind of ridiculous. Yeah.
I think putting a cinema under an underpass. Why not just have the underpass and leave it empty?
I've introduced that project from a critical perspective. Mm. I find it quite unsatisfying having built something, taking it down. I mean, whether you like that work or not, you're stuck with it as a member of the public, and that's a really important. I mean, I drive past that chimney a lot, and it's not a very pretty road either. I haven't had any choice in that. And this goes back to this thing about public and public service and democracy and all those ideas that were thought about quite carefully when we're talking about Verity's examples of public art that was commissioned in the past. And I think what we're really looking at is the privatisation of the entire city. Public space isn't public anymore. Clever people decide what we all look at and where we go, and you've got private police and security operations all over the city. I think it's really worrying. I think what's also worrying is the fact that young people and the people who are studying here will not be able to afford to live in this city. So you can make all the nice art and have a nice studio, but in 10 years' time, you're going to have to leave because you will not be able to afford to live here unless you're super, super, super successful.
So here's an idea.
And I think that's a shame for London.
But it's interesting, this idea of art being used as a sticking plaster, you know, which is criticised so often. You know, why isn't the chimney itself beautiful enough? Why do we have to cover it in art? Hasn't that always been the case? You know, in the Renaissance, you would stick sculptures on buildings because buildings themselves were quite mundane. You would paint the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel because the ceiling itself was a workaday ceiling. Should we be worried about art being a sticking plaster, or is it an inevitability that it's
Verity showed the cladding in the was it Harlow wherever it was, Hatfield, you know, with a concrete cladding system on the outside that had an artwork on it. Richard, you'd say take it off, wouldn't you, and just leave the brick behind it. I mean, that would be probably a good idea.
I'm not going to be the chief fool guy. No, and what's more, I knew William Mitchell, so okay. I actually thought that was how lovely that he should turn up. But what, obviously, the question really, it's not even a question. It's like that there's a perfectly, there are many, many things which this audience is qualified to do to me. We know this table is some kind of bad joke. Okay? It's not very funny, but it's a bad joke. The floor is less funny. It's not great, but we read it differently. Okay? And I'm a lot older than you, but you've been in a place with a lino floor, and we've got feelings about whether that could be good or bad. So we are making, everybody here is making judgments about, everybody here for sure is making judgments about how they're dressed, and the person next to them is making judgments about how they look. That's something that's part of this culture. So my underlying question is, what is this swirl whirl of all the things you're talking about? I mean, I think you've been terrific. You've presented, it's all on the table, engineering, the word policy, even the dreaded word legacy and heritage, they both popped up. I had a little card and I marked them when they came up. But really, you know, the people in this audience who are probably a third of my age, you know,
Well, we've got someone of that description holding the other microphone, so.
I just wanted to ask a little bit about the flight of artists from London, and in some respects, you could argue that artists maybe have less of a need to be local than a doctor or a teacher. So my question is, do you think artists have a right to resilience to stay where they are?
Do artists have a right to stay where they are, essentially?
I think they have as much right as anyone else on a low salary.
Yeah. I think it's if you view yourself solely as a hat with your as an artist with your first hat, or as a citizen with your first hat. And I think we have every right to the city as the next person, especially when, you know, you can work ridiculously hard and not get paid much money.
Should they be key workers?
No.
No, I don't think you're a key worker.
Keyhole workers.
It's really tricky. I think this conversation about the need and the necessity for developers to hand over the ground floor of their schemes to artist workspaces, light industrial, that's great, but where are we going to live? Who are these mythical artists who are going to be able to A, afford to rent them, and B, commute to them? Because we won't have that, the local relationship. But I don't think that's I'm more worthy or I need that more than we need hospitals or schools. But it's the conversation.
Creators currently designing some artists' dwelling units in Barking. Hmm. Could you talk a bit about that?
We haven't announced that project yet, Ollie. But
I think the Guardian has already published mention of it.
We're really, really concerned about the fact that we're much less interested in studio space. We're much more interested in housing. So we are building a community centre, actually, in the middle of a town centre in Barking, which happens to have 12 apartments above it, which have been designed in conversation, collaboration with artists, and they will be very attractive, very functional places to live. And we're thinking about the community centre, which happens to be a hall about this size on the ground floor, being a space that with a public programme that is run by our resident artists, and whether or not we can make as a part of a tenancy some time that each artist would spend on maybe half a day a week.
In order to justify an affordable rent.
In order to think about how there may be a role for artists in places which are really losing community infrastructure and that works for someone who is a freelancer on a low salary, which is what most artists are. So it's a pathfinding project. But it isn't crappy housing in a crappy place, and this is why many artists are moving to places like Margate. It's not just because it's cheap, it's because the buildings are well made. There's big windows, there's the sea, and you can't offer rubbish accommodation for people that are really interested in how things look. So that's an experiment. Yeah. But
do you want to respond to the question, any of you think?
About resilience.
Yeah, about resilience and if artists have a kind of right.
I think it's a tough one. I mean, when I was an artist, I had a studio in Deptford, and I was in there until, I think, for 12 years, and I live in that area. And you move and flow where the energy is, where the ideas are, where the money is, where the opportunities are. And they've been in London for a long time, and London is changing. And it's not changing because of a developer. It's changing because the city has been selling itself as a cultural city for, in a very overt way, for nearly 10 years. And as I said, you know, my brief talk, the mayor announced 3 days ago that they want the whole of the estuary from London outwards to Southend and Canvey Island to be a creative hub. So this is the effect. And maybe you'd argue a good thing is it spreads artists out to the edges of the city, to Barking, to Romford, and out that way, and west towards Southall and so on. So, you know, that sometimes there's a good effect and other areas get the benefit of artists and they create new places. So I'm very worried about anything that trap kind of corrals creative people into one place artificially.
Anna, has space looked into providing housing ever or subsidising?
Oh, we've tried many times. Live work, most planning authorities are really allergic to it because they assume that it'll become residential through the back door. So that's why they resist it. I think everyone tries to be resilient in London, you know, economically, sort of in terms of health. I think there's a huge mental health resilience problem in London because it is so darn competitive. And inevitably, in the future, to survive in London, you've either got to be very rich or incredibly resourceful. And I think it means the people who survive in London are very smart, very intelligent, and at the top of the game, because you have to be to survive. It's not a lazy city. You can't afford to rest on your laurels or sit in coffee shops.
I think it's about part resilience, part innovation, and I suppose a little bit of sacrifice, I guess. I think unquestionably London is a more exciting place for artists. That's a given. And the direction in which London is moving, it's suffocating creative ambition, not just through, it's about headspace, but also architectural space. But London's loss could be other areas' gains, as Mark touches on. And that's not an excuse, and I think more needs to be done. But I suppose also I shouldn't say this, but artists do have a responsibility also to facilitate their own evolution of their practice, perhaps their career, and their own survival. And typically, as a young artist, there's no progress without sacrifice. And resilience, yes, but also in the form of innovation. And you know, that program is an innovative one without sacrifice. And that's a kind of a rare, kind of a wonderful marriage. But it's, yeah, I think. I think resilience is critical, but it's not the only critical ingredient for an artist's survival. Okay. Yeah.
Sorry, but times are changing so much, and to go back to what Hadrian was saying about 10 years, 15 years, young artists will just be forced to leave. When I graduated, not even that long ago, relatively in 2003, I was still able to sign on the dole, live on someone's sofa, and exist. And I could get housing benefit and really commit to trying to be an artist. For a short term, I worked in a bar, did lots of cash, hand-to-mouth jobs. And that space, I'm not suggesting every graduate should go on the dole, but it was certainly a different time, which certainly helped me in my pathway to a career. I don't know what I would have done without that.
That's a really interesting point, isn't it? I was thinking about that as well earlier, that As a fine art graduate now, you know, you'd leave with a 27,000 or whatever it is debt, which kind of almost makes you, you're straight into the kind of economics of living with that debt over you, all of the expectation that comes with it. Mm-hmm. You know, when we studied, you know, I go even further, obviously further back than you, and you know, you'd left with no debt, and you could go on the dole, and you could find bits of money, and it was easier to squat, and it just feels harder now, and but at the same time, the new breed of artists that we're dealing with, and we'd work with a lot of young and emerging artists, about 40% of the artists we work with are young emerging artists, and all of them, I think, are, you know, they're entrepreneur or culturepreneurial, to use the term that someone mentioned recently. They're culturepreneurial. They're out there. They are forming groups. They're finding different ways to make money and to survive as artists. And there's a lot more cross-disciplinary groups stemming from that, from those groups. They're architects, designers working together with sound people and so on. It's a much more interesting mix of artists that we're tending to find now.
The thing is, it's going to kill sculpture.
Why is that?
Well, you need space. Okay. I mean, yeah, but it's not going to help
minimalist. Very small. Sculpture.
I mean, I know a lot of people who have multidisciplinary practices that just are choosing not to make sculptures.
Well, it's the same in studios. I mean, these guys know they have one room to share for the entire architecture department, which means you make very small models. I think we've got time for about two more questions, if there's any burning. Okay, one there. Final question there. Yeah.
Do you think that public art should educate people? We're here in a school. What do you think should be the relationship between art in general and education?
Is the role of public art to educate the public in some sense? Is that?
I think post-war art was.
Sometimes. I think the idea of function is really interesting. I think things that are functional, that are useful, are of kind of immediate value. So I quite like the idea of a educational piece of public art in a school. I think that's quite potentially quite exciting, but clearly not always.
No. Is the answer no? Never. It shouldn't be. It should just be what it is, and art should go out there and provoke and be what it is. And if that particular project has an educational element as part of it, so be it. But there's something really wonderful, isn't there, about someone just going out and placing something on the ground and walking away. I think I'd prefer it like that, really.
Verity, do you see your work having a kind of didactic responsibility?
Fuck. I mean, teach. I don't know, yeah? Maybe sometimes. I do quite a lot of educational work. I'm definitely not out there trying to change lives or educate. If that happens by proxy, great. Mm. And I think for me, potentially, I'm more interested in informal modes of education and the less tangible what exists outside of school, outside of formalised community groups. So I'd see a success model in my practices that I've managed to maintain relationships. And I have recurring people come and take part in work that would definitely not say they like art. but they are now
they love it.
I don't think it's a case of love it, but I suppose that's an informal education, which I think is really valuable.
Anna?
I would have thought that anything that provokes conversation is educational, so hopefully something that's a bit different provokes debate, and I think that's an educational in a very broad sense. Also, you know, something that creates a sense of identity for a place. Is that educational?
I think the opposite of something with no purpose that's just there to like surprise me or and sort of make something look pretty. I just don't want to look at it. I'd rather look at adverts. At least they have a function, which is like trying to sell you something. I don't want to see an object. You know, I don't. And if it's a political thing, like it's a prince on a horse in Trafalgar Square, that's fine, because there's a political agenda that you can read into that. I don't want this kind of, I've really surprised you out of your day. It's like, no, I've got enough of that.
There's also a political message about the commissioning of that surprise piece, you know, that you could engage with.
I just think there's an arrogance there, which is like, I'm going to plonk this in front of you, and I've also engaged the community, because I've talked to them a bit, and we've got evidence of it, because we did a publication. And there's such an arrogance in that. It's like, I like the fourth plinth because it goes. Yeah. You know, I think that's terrific. It's brilliant. It's there for a bit. You can look at it if you want, but then it's gone. And I think that's a very good public project. But I can think of very few public art things that I want to look at. Mm.
I think with the Mobile Museum, one of the both failures of the business model, let's say, which is why I'm not rich.
It's the clutch.
one of the reasons. But also, the programme was not defined before the project started. I didn't design it off plan in my studio in Hackney. I spend a really long time in each estate trying to work out what the workshop, what the activity, what will happen within this particular context.
There's not a lot of public art in London. If you just when you leave tonight, just walk. Not once you get past the
art on loads the, on, around here.
Yeah, I know. Once you get out of here, where there's a lot, just walk and then count street signage and adverts and buildings and other bits and pieces
paving.
All around you. But what?
Paving.
Paving, and you will find very little public art. For all the fuss about public art, in the scheme of things, there is very little.
But I think that's part of the problem, Mark, in that where we find it is often enclaved within new developments. So it's not within the everyday. It's normally symptomatic of where something's being developed, where the money is, which is why we're surrounded by tons of public
it's
art.
A visual amenity for the rest of
us. Go further out to Summertown, there's no public
and
art.
And it's so often about engaging a community. It's so often just a shortcut to prove that you're having a conversation with a community in a big development.
Yeah. We did that.
Just go out and do boring consultation. It's cheaper. Well, it depends who you hire.
Yeah.
It's cheaper, and you don't need to sort of case it in some sort of spiritual
sugary
meaning,
wrapping.
Which is just kind of...
And there can be less shit up.
The final question was somewhere over there. Yeah. Do you have a microphone?
So what's the role of architects in this discussion? they seem to have been lumped in with the developers in kind of a bad world of developers. But surely they're kind of this bridge between the artists and the developers. So surely they're part of the solution to help.
Or are they the victims having public art bolted onto their buildings? Where do the architects fit into all this? Is it symptomatic that the architecture isn't good enough, that it needs public art to dress it up?
I think it's a responsibility of architectures to design our public realm, and I think that's what they do, and that's terrific. And I also think there's nothing wrong with developers developing whatever they want to develop. I'm not anti-developers. I just think it becomes murky when you start fiddling in that model with art. It's just strange.
And when artists are brought in as the afterthought, it's so obvious that it's the afterthought. It's like, oh shit, we've got a bit of money left, or we need to justify this. Let's put an art. Let's do an art and have it over there, and we can do some meaningful engagement. Great, tick tick tick.
I think architects have been given a role over the last 10, particularly over the last 17 years, as the kind of keeper of all things, and the problem is, to some extent, is I think they've got too much to do, and I think having specialists to work with who know about art, who work with artists, and can bring something, bridge to that process, I think is a good thing. But I think sometimes architects become the kind of deliverer of the developers, if you like, vision, and they are the key.
But that's their job, isn't it?
Well, no, not really.
Well, it is, because they build the place that's being paid for to build. So,
well, it depends what their job is, isn't it? I mean, if their job is to master plan, that's one thing, but then what is master planning? If it's about building particular buildings within the scheme, if it's about doing accommodation for students, I mean, it depends what the brief is to them, but they're not everything, are they? I mean, are they, I don't know, Renaissance, like kind of Frank Lloyd Wright? Is that what you're thinking?
I think currently, though, very often what architects actually design is very far removed from what's delivered. And I think the things that are compromised from plan to the world is the public art component, the section 106. Like, shit, we've run out of money. Let's make the windows a centimetre smaller. Let's get rid of those water features. Let's ditch the bollards. And we won't use granite.
But we'll have a nice sculptor instead.
Or not.
Mostly or not.
No, but often the value engineering happens, but the money for art is ring-fenced.
I think it's all old hat, that, because are we so naive that a piece of sculpture at the front of a building fools us into buying it, fools the planners into putting another six stories on the top, and covers the ugliness of the architectural because it's been cost stripped out? I mean, maybe I don't know. You should just show us a piece, and we'd all go and look at it after here. We'll all go down and see.
Alex, given that the architecture is the subject of a lot of your work, what's your relationship with it?
Well, I think in the city it's quite a frustrating one, because I think the buildings that we're thinking of, and the developers that we're talking about, and the artworks that surround them, are they're conceived with some kind of spirit of design and innovation in mind. I think across the city, the biggest problem is the just copy and paste architecture that is conceived, built, delivered, sold, occupied with nothing but profit margins in mind. And that is just so uninspiring. And you can, you know, attack public artworks all you like. The most damaging thing is these generic, unimaginative, uninspiring structures which define and occupy our public realm. I mean, a building, every building is a public artwork, or it's an opportunity to be one. And it's so often wasted. And where does the problem lie? I mean, a lot of architecture practices are just concerned with their own survival. Some of them see their own survival intrinsic with creativity, which is a great scenario. But I think planning, not officers, because don't shoot the messengers, but planning policies, or the whole philosophy around what's an acceptable building, needs a complete revision and overhaul. And I mean, it's just terrifying, I think, that they're more inclined to approve a generic, risk-free, you know, as I say, copy and paste design, as opposed to one that takes a risk, which is conceived with a small or large dose of imagination, because it's risk-free, you know, and it's safe. And people are so afraid of making the wrong decision, they never really make the right one. And I think that's my problem with architecture in the city. It's an insult to even call it architecture. They're just structures of profit.
Anna, are you working with architects on the Here East shelf-based studios?
Yeah, with Hawkins Brown and Zero Zero Architects.
And how are you finding that process?
We're not the client, so...
But that's interesting in itself.
That their brief is to design a cabinet of curiosities. It was not a brief that we set. Studios don't need to be that. We could do with something much more basic.
So is the architecture in that case trying to be too artistic because they're designing artist studios? They're doing novelty pods.
The planners want it to look creative. It's like all these planners who require active frontages. And then these developers come and see us saying, we'd love to put artists in the window doing their easel painting because it'll be great because customers can come straight and buy it directly from the artists. And we get that so... You know, why do planners think that artists want active frontages and sit in goldfish bowls? I just don't know. And then poor architects have to deal with this scenario. I think it's a really tough job being an architect today, trying to please all these different people. There's so many different
I went with an architect and a developer to some studios, which would be nameless, because they were interested in putting studios into their development. And we walked in, and I can remember someone had the key, and we walked in and someone was asleep on the floor covered in newspapers. And we just stood there and then we all walked out and there were no studios in that development. And hooray, you know, it was a great moment. Just an artist asleep on the floor covered in newspapers.
A cheery note to end on, I think. An artist's future covered in newspapers on the floor. All that's left for me to do is to ask you guys to thank our amazing panel and to join us in the bar.